verification systems, etc. Everything will come under cognitive exercises. So there are two things. One is instinctive drive, second is cognitive drive. And they have some exercises. For example, if you want to take bath, there are some methodologies. Either the water will flow on you, or you have to make the water flow, you have to take the water, you have to subject your head inside, you have to wash your pots. These are all the exercises. Likewise, in the divine bath, which is known as Jnana Snana, don't mislead this thing to somewhere else. Jnana Snana, wherein we are taking some divine bath, taking bath in divine wisdom, inexhaustible wisdom, we are governing some exercises. Those exercises are very casual. For any lover of knowledge, for anybody who is epistemomaniac, for anybody who is epistemologically having a commitment to know about the trace of knowledge, to know about the original imbibition of knowledge, inhibition of knowledge, and those who can rejoice that knowledge, such people certainly will have automatically the resources to be processed inside without an external urge acting upon it. But now we are in such a situation that each and everything should be urged, like that somebody should rub onion hereafter in the eyes of the modern students or the modern children of the society to get some tears when seeing about the wisdom or seeing their mothers, which is a natural provocation of the biological matter, which is to do with the enzymic and harmonic reactions of the eco-psycho-physiological interventions that has necessitated now a chemical urge, a transformational urge. Some sort of booster and some sort of a demand from the society to create all of those things. What are they? Observation, then verification, retention, experimentation, then conclusion and systematization. These are the exercises that are there in a person's normal pursuit. These are the major skills. And how to get these things? There are three modes. We used to call in Shastras, they are gatis. Number one, you can gain from experience. Number two, you can gain from insight. Number three, you can gain from access. From your experience, you can gain some things. Without even experiencing, having your previous experience as an investment tool or a marginal internal cognitive investment, you can process it within your mind. So, it is drishti vishayika avagata jnana dvara adrishta vishayasya avagamanam. That is known as intuitive processing. Whatever you have learned, there are two things. In total absolute darkness, you can see the light. If you have some friction elements, you can produce light. So, great rishis, by closing the eyes, by sitting in an inner pose, they used to derive everything without the need for any personal subjection or personal demonstration that is required or implied in modern process, number one. And number two is, whatever you gain, as a fraction, as a fragment, as a small scintillant, using that you can process without the aid of external things. That is what I have told. In the form of a starter, you can get the information from the society and process them inside. So, whatever you gain by your subjective experience, connective experience, optical experience, related experience, and transmitted experience, and lineage of experiences which you get in the form of aitihya from various people, you can develop knowledge. Second is, whatever you have had inside, you can process by means of thinking in solitude, thinking with multitude, and thinking in magnitude. You can develop the same thing inside your mind. And third thing is access. You have never experienced at all and you have got no insight, but there will be the records of those people, either the reminiscences or the records or the residues of the people who have understood the knowledge through the process of insight and experience. You have not done those things. We are not doing agriculture, but we are getting the product from fields. We are not doing the weeding, but we are getting the output in the form of clothes. Likewise, access is the model by which already available records, reminiscences and residues of great people can be easily absorbed by three processes. Now, in the advent of technology, no personal relation is required. Now, personal subjection, relation, connection, and submission are the four tools for gaining knowledge. In our ancestral system, you must directly see your master, that is acharya, not a teacher, or a tutor, or a preacher. I am telling you, okay, preceptor, a divine radiant personality, you have to see him. You have to be in the presence, that is known as Sanidhya. And you must be always there with his motion along with him, that is known as Sangati. And you must be very intimate and submissive to him. That's what I call as subservience. Then by this process of being with him, moving with him, being intimate with him and submitting everything without speech, without any literary transmission, without the transmission by means of any tools that are there, technical or manual in nature, they used to get knowledge as an instantaneous processing technology which automatically happens reflection of a metaconsciousness in a microconsciousness. So it is a process of expansion of a receptacle in which the reflection of a mega consciousness that instills inside a person, a receptacle, like a kanadhara. It happens so. Now it is far beyond human thought and practicality of today. So let us talk something about which is practically mobile in the society. Number one, with the records now available in the form of three things. One is book, second is direct or distant learning, third things are sound records. We are having Rupa Grahana in the form of scripts, Shabda Grahana in the form of CDs, and Vyavahara in the form of distant learning, then teleconferencing systems, then online registration, everything has come now. You need not see the person at all in your life, but you will be getting everything. So these are all the various methodologies that are there in knowledge. And knowledge also, according to Shastra, they are trifold. Number one, absolute knowledge. Second thing is abundant knowledge. Third thing is associative knowledge. Absolute knowledge is knowing everything without any reference, eternally, having an evergreen memory, and also ever potential, ever ready, dynamic, explicit prowess of a person to implement and to extraordinarily perform those things, resulting in infallible success. That is the work of only two people, the Eternals and the Eternal Personality of Godhead, who is known as Paramatma or Brahman. They are having absolute knowledge. Liberated people, the Eternals, and the eternally eternal universal spiritual reality, that is Brahman, they are having that absolute knowledge. And those who are delegated by the divinity, they will be having the second status of knowledge, which is known as abundant knowledge, knowing about more things. Lot of things are grasped inside a person, various other things which are far beyond a human cognitive load, bearability, that will be possessed by some people. And third knowledge is what we want. We don't want absolute knowledge, we don't want abundant knowledge. Even if somebody gives, we cannot take that. See, somebody is throwing a big bar of iron on you, that is about 1 ton. Immediately the head will be smashed. Somebody is throwing the same 1 ton weight in gold. What will be the difference between the head being smashed in both of the throwings? Whether it is anugraha or nigraha, whether it is a gift or a curse, that which is beyond our bearability is a peril in disguise, indubitably. Like that, what we want is associative knowledge. What is associative knowledge? To possess the knowledge, number one, to possess the knowledge which is connected to our general and exclusive functioning, number one. Number two, whenever we expand, we must try to unlearn whatever we have learned and relearn the circumstances so that we can be effectively having a perennial way of performance and skill in the moving society, number two. Number three, ability to master and learn new things and adapt new informations, new circumstances. This is known as associative knowledge. This associative knowledge is not ever ready, but it is having a space. It is having some adaptability to adapt the environment, to adapt the new entries, to adapt the new exposures that he is going to face in the society. This is known as associative knowledge. Now nobody is having even the associative knowledge. The third knowledge, which we call as adhama, that is not there in the society, so that we have to create a new category known as adhama-dhama, the inferior most. So this is the system of knowledge, and I want to say something about the components, various other tools of knowledge. Number one, it has three systems. One is education, which is the methodology, and you know that classroom, school, everything is the infrastructure or the environment for that particular methodology. So education, student and teacher, they are the three tools. What is education? Education would be so effective so that it should erase whatever that is contrary to that of the instructional environment that is there in the educational campus. Number one, there are two things. One is exhort.